Okay, so recording is started. So we basically last day we ended at this this kind of premise that in order that the continuity equation is valid, then we have certain restrictions on the dielectric tensor. And so let me share my screen. Okay. Right. So we basically
Sir, we can't hear you.
Oops. What happened? Hello, can you guys hear? Yeah, can you guys hear me?
Yes, sir, now we can.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I was thrown out, I think, somehow. Let me wait. This BSNL is completely crazy. Let me just. Just will change it. Okay, it may throw me out again. Then I will. Yeah, I need to change this from BSNL. Can you hear me still?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I made the network change. Okay, I need to share my screen again. Yeah, so how long, I don't know how long you heard, but basically what I was saying was that in order to, for the continuity equation to hold, we kind of imply that we get that epsilon xy is equal to epsilon yx, which is basically meaning that epsilon is a symmetric tensor. Symmetric tensor, and which we now diagonalize the tensor, and we sort of go to the principal axis coordinate system. And the moment we do that, all the off diagonal elements are gone. And so essentially when we work in the principal axis, principal coordinate system, we eliminate the off diagonal terms, and so we get and we obtain things like your dx is epsilon naught epsilon ex, dy is epsilon naught epsilon y ey, and dz is epsilon naught epsilon z ez. And very importantly, the energy density W, that is half epsilon naught. This is very critical. Dx square epsilon x plus dy square epsilon y plus dz square epsilon z. This is very critical. And you can straight see that this actually describes an ellipsoid. And this is essentially called the, this is basically called the index, not this exactly. Well, we will define the index ellipsoid in a different way, but it comes from there. But what is this telling you? That from a given point, these d vectors, they kind of make a surface of constant energy. That is very important. So there, the constant energy, so this implies that the constant energy surface is essentially an ellipsoid, which is interesting. So we will, of course, write down the index ellipsoid somewhat later. But you can see that now we have this kind of a region. So we will, come to the principal axis and all that later on. We will also very clearly see that, now it's already clear to, I think, to some extent, that the thing that we got, the parameter or the wave property that we deal with in anisotropic media is D, not E. We will find out that there are many, many interesting things, how the pointing vector behaves, and various other things. So but here we are kind of setting up the ground for defining this this thing that we will come later on, the index ellipsoid, where we typically completely characterize the an anisotropic media with respect to that. So we will of course see that the three axes correspond to the the 3 degrees of the polarization and all that. So we will also see that when you have the wave propagating in a certain direction, there can actually be 2 orthogonal polarizations. So that is again very interesting. That is not what you see when you have a wave propagating through isotropic media. Here it is very interesting, and the 2 polarizations actually will have 2 different phase velocities, which is also going to be clear when we write down the same kind of an equation in the refractive index notation. Okay, so before we progress, okay, so now right now what we shall look at is very important. I mean, this is where we really go into the details of anisotropic media, and that is we consider the wave propagation in anisotropic media. So this is absolutely critical, and this is what is going to really open this field for us in anisotropic media. And so as I said, we consider, so let me just write down this wave equation first. And as I said, we are writing this we are not writing the field in terms of E. Okay, so can you sort of justify this? Something like this. Can you justify this? Why we are sticking to D and not E? Why do you think that D is what the displacement vector is, what displacement field is what we should look at, and not the electric field, just the E vector? What is the critical justification that you feel makes us go towards this?
Sir, since now epsilon is not constant, direction of polarization should change, like it would change the direction of E.
If you multiply epsilon fundamental by E. Just think of the Maxwell equations with respect to me. Yeah, you are correct. The polarization, right? Polarization is now in the direction of the D will specify my polarization, but why? Can we think a bit deeply? Think in terms of the basic Maxwell equations. Maxwell equations, kya hoga? Critically, I'm giving the big hint. Ye kya hoga?
Sir, the Maxwell's equation, if the Maxwell's equation would have been the same form, then you have to write
del dot
divergence of D. It will be equal to zero.
So this one will.
So if it is D, then del dot D. Right?
This is not zero, right?
This is not zero, this but not zero. D.
Exactly. Very good. Is the class following this? This is a very, very critical assumption. This is crucial because del dot E is no longer zero. Important, right? And why is it no longer zero? Because this is not a constant. This is a tensor now. This is zero, which is essentially meaning that K dot D is zero, which means D specifies my polarization. I should not write my. Specifies the polarization direction. Extremely important, and that will completely, now allow us to write, the whole thing is now very, very different. Okay. So everything else remains the same, of course. Your K and all, everything is same. K obviously is omega by V and all that. Omega by V and V is V by N. All that remains the same. But crucially, K dot D is zero, and D specifies my polarization direction and not E. Which now let me write down all the four Maxwell's equations the Maxwell equations become del dot D is zero, del dot B is zero, del cross H is del T, and del cross this is okay. Is minus del V del T. Okay, this is crucial. Okay, so now let us go to this wave equation from here.
How do we know that del dot E is not zero?
In the sense that it is not necessarily zero.
Okay, so basically,
this is always zero. Huh? Sorry?
Andrew? Are we saying that some charge densities that are.
There are no free charges, right? We don't have any source. We are not. Okay, you're saying that if there is any rho, no, this is a source free region, of course. There are bound things, so unless you put light, there is nothing happening. Okay, so these are, when initially there is no light. So,
equation del dot E is equals to rho by epsilon, is that valid inside an anisotropic media or not?
In the sense that, see, that is rho by, that Yeah, see, the basic Maxwell's equations will not change, right? Why will those change? Those will not change, right?
If you're saying that it's not necessarily zero, then...
In the sense that, no, the reason that I'm saying... See, what we have is del dot epsilon is zero, right? The actual Maxwell's equation is del dot epsilon, this thing. And we take that epsilon is a constant, we take it out and we say del dot E is zero. But now you cannot do that, right? Now you have that epsilon is a function of space. I mean, it is essentially different. It's no longer isotropic. So epsilon, the property of the material is not the same in all directions. Right? So whatever you have in isotropic media, everything holds, except for the fact that the, you know, epsilon I cannot just take as a constant. So del dot epsilon E has to be zero. Epsilon is obviously D. So del dot D is zero. Okay, that is the basic logic. So the anisotropy comes in the variation of epsilon, in the sense that the properties of the material are no longer the same in all directions. So I'm saying that the displacement field is what I characterize my electromagnetic wave is now characterized by the displacement field. Okay, this is still a source free region. There are no free charges, or there are no sort of, this is just anisotropic media, not assuming any kind of sources which create an external source which creates a field or whatever. Okay, so the wave equation, we can again go by this, but it will be obviously very, very different. It is like, of course, this is fine, and obviously this will become del dot E minus del square E is minus del T del cross B, and then all those things will come. So basically what you have is del dot E minus del square E equals minus mu zero del square D del T square. Okay. So Anirudh, are you fine with that?
Yeah, I still have to think about it in detail, like from the basics of Maxwell's equation. I'll do it on my own.
Yeah, you can figure that. But the basic thing is that you are essentially incorporating the anisotropic media from the viewpoint that epsilon is no longer a constant. So why? I mean, everything else, there is no difference, right? The only thing that is happening is that as you change direct, I mean, as we sort of, you said before yesterday, right, that the when we did it, that when we have an incident field, you know, then the depending on which way I orient my crystal, it is going to essentially it is going to experience a different environment, right? So nothing else is changing, and I'm not sort of, you know, inducing, I mean, I'm not having any, see, this is again so source free, so that is very clear. I don't have free charges around, right? You are inducing bound charges, but when you change, basically when you change the orientation of the crystal with respect to the field experiences a different environment, and that is manifested in the change of this thing.
I just want to recap on why the Maxwell equation is del dot epsilon E is equal to zero instead of just del dot E equal to zero.
So okay, that you have to go to the derivation. Ha, wo thoda dekhna hoga. Ha, that is not bad.
Ha, that okay, I'll
sure.
see that.
Sure. Okay. Anyway, so let us proceed. So basically, then what we have is so this is what we have. So then isse jo aata hai. So we have like del square E minus del of del dot E. So Anirudh, if you find something interesting, do share with us. If you have some nice, you know, realization, be nice to share. So I'm writing again this in terms of an E equation. This is fine. D I'm writing like this. Okay. So now remember, again, we shall work in the principle coordinate system where this is
diagonal, right? Right, so then this is working.
Okay, so that means I can, so let us consider, so basically it's diagonal, okay, and let us consider the x component. Okay, which is basically then something like del square E del x square plus del square, oh, sorry, E x. Del square x del y square plus del square x del z square minus del x del x del x plus del y del y plus del z del z is epsilon naught. Acha, please be very careful. This, I am sure I'm going to mess up one epsilon naught or mu zero or something somewhere. Huh? Please be very attentive. This is, I keep confusing with these all epsilons and mu's, and this part is okay, right? This is just peaceful. Okay, so we know that your epsilon naught, epsilon x, ex is your dx. And this dx we can basically write as some d0 ka x coordinate e to the minus I omega t minus kxx. This kxx plus kyy plus kzz. Okay, this is fine. Now we know that, of course, your del x matlab, that is like your ikx, and you know that your del t is of course omega. So this implies that I can write this epsilon naught epsilon x mu zero del square ex del t square. I can basically write as minus mu zero omega square dx. Is that fine? That's fine, right? A minus hai, two times one hai, minus this thing. Minus aa jayega yahan pe. Right? Minus mu zero and everything is this one is dx. So this is fine. Okay? Okay. Now let us go to the next new sheet. Please be very, very, you know, attentive. I any point I can make mistake.
Sir, it was minus I omega t, right? So if we'll take double derivative.
Oh, minus here, ga.
Ah, ठीक है दस.
अरे, क्या?
No sir.
अच्छा ठीक है तो तेरा देख एक मिनट. ए जी आप अभी please be careful. I mess up this calculation badly at times. Okay, so let us write. So that means तेरा del square del x square is minus k x square. हाँ. Del square del y square is minus k y square, and del square del z square is minus k z square. Obviously, your del x is I k x. Is obviously fine. Okay. Okay. Now see. Okay. So that previous equation. Oh man. Okay. Oh, okay. So the previous equation was some. Okay, so that one, so we had del square plus del square, huh? Okay, right. So basically, ye k del square del square x square, so it was something like del this one e x square plus kuch tha na e y square. Oh no, that what am I writing? So it was basically sabka ye tha del square x square plus del square y square plus del square this z square ex, right. Okay, yeah. So that means right. So this is this one, then we have del square. Okay, let me just drop this.
So we had x square x. X plus del squared del y squared ey plus del squared del square. Oh, sorry, kya likh rahe hain yaar? This is all ex, right? Del squared del z squared ex. So that basically becomes minus mod of k squared dx by epsilon x, right? This is okay. Is there an epsilon zero? Wait. हाँ एप्सिलॉन जीरो भी है राइट ओह पेज आई शुड नॉट हैव डन Yeah, so this one. Okay, so that means this. So the, yeah, this is so be okay, right? So this is we kx square plus ky square plus kz square, ex, and instead of ex we have dx by epsilon zero epsilon x. Correct? Yes. There's an epsilon zero, yeah, right? Okay, good. Okay. So then, what we can write is this one. So we can write the wave equation as k squared dx by epsilon x epsilon zero minus kx by epsilon naught. Kx dx plus ky oh यहाँ पे epsilon ये होगा ky dy epsilon y plus kz dz epsilon z equals mu zero omega squared dx correct is this correct is minus sign when kuch theek hai I think it's okay so epsilon naught can go there okay so maybe we can just write this epsilon naught on that side epsilon naught can be written on that side epsilon naught so let us dividing by this mod k square we basically get dx by epsilon x minus kx by mod k square kx dx by epsilon x plus ky dy by epsilon y plus kz dz by epsilon z equal to the same thing epsilon naught mu naught omega square dx by your k square okay now this is what k square is your v by c right so v c so if I say that the velocity of light is c zero then this is basically this k square is n square omega square by some c zero square right so c zero is velocity of light in vacuum of light in vacuum right so now see now things are very simple so your omega square so consider rhs then you have this omega square cancel ये c zero square what is क्या so that is so you have c zero is what c zero square is 1/ε0μ0 right huh so then this is 1/c0 1/c0 square so this is also cancelling है ना so basically you are going to get only the just your dx by n square are you guys with me
huh? so can this you repeat fine? the last part again
so yeah yeah so basically yeah. hum jo bol rahe hai epsilon this is okay up to this is okay right mod yes, k square I'm writing as just see k is v by this thing right v by c so I'm writing that as this thing your
c by n
ha 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 n c by n and then that becomes this n omega by c right so n square omega by c square so then now okay. c0 square is 1/ε0μ0 right so this is basically nothing but ε0μ0 okay. so then this whole thing gets cancelled right so yes. you have only this theek hai na so then I have basically your dx by epsilon x minus this k kx by mod k square this whole thing right this kx dx by epsilon x plus ky dy by epsilon y plus kz dz by epsilon z equal to this dx by n square okay okay now there is this assumption that so this is what this Christopher Davis acha usme na there is I if you just look at it I have already uploaded it so I think they have a mistake okay so what basically they do they just write down so this whole thing they consider as some p square okay so basically what they do is let this whole this thing this yeah so they consider that this let kx dx by epsilon x plus ky dy by epsilon y plus kz dz by epsilon z c0 square by mod of k square they consider as some p square okay so that basically means that you have dx by epsilon x minus kx p square by c0 square equal to dx by n square acha please check if this is okay because that Christopher Davis they have an epsilon not here and I don't know why that is there so that I have not found that I don't is there any problem you feel so this is just some kind of a see this is a this whole thing is a they consider this as some kind of a constant some principal you know p square some kind of a surface which they consider as a this thing but they have an epsilon not here but I don't see where there is an epsilon not extra that I am missing okay but this is however fine I mean I don't see any problem at all so do you think there is an epsilon not I don't find any epsilon not so that book I think there is an extra epsilon not they have put I don't think there
sir but I yeah same
there is no epsilon not right
the epsilon or we have already
considered right over the niche ta I have put it here so that is wrong so that yeah. epsilon not should not be there okay acha so now we are done so basically what we have is this dx 1/ε x and I'm taking this to the left hand side minus 1/n² this is essentially kx p square by c 0 not square and
sir this epsilon not thing I have seen this same thing with the Cramer's Kronig relation as well when we derived the real and the imaginary part there we wrote real part of epsilon that is epsilon 1 But in Jackson, I think they have written real part of epsilon by epsilon naught.
Hitesh, so that basically they are taking the relative permittivity and all that. That I don't think is an important thing. Na? But here I see that that is like in the sense that you write that, see, that depends. So at times, for example, what we have considered in Grindr also, what they do is that they take the relative permittivity to be considered to be inside, that epsilon naught is inside that. So, some people write that as epsilon r and some people write it as epsilon naught into something. That is probably okay. So here,
but have this problem because when you evaluate the imaginary part from the real part, there we write the imaginary part is related to the real part of epsilon by epsilon naught minus 1. So,
I will tell you. So that we wrote epsilon r minus 1, right? And yes. Jackson writes that epsilon r by epsilon naught minus 1 and epsilon. So they are kind of, that is a convention actually, right? So that is the electric field equation when they write. We write it as, so for example, we write that E as epsilon naught epsilon r into this. Whereas Jackson may write that dust as epsilon r. Okay, so when you only write the relative permittivity, you have
you should not face any problem in the assignment, right? Because I checked that. I wrote minus 1 there instead of epsilon 0.
Yes, exactly. So I think that is whatever you take, that is a convention. You take that as a convention. Here I have a problem because I do not see where that epsilon naught comes in from. I think that's a mistake because I absolutely don't find that any question of that epsilon naught coming. Okay. So this is, however, very crucial because once you have this, I can basically write my dx. Once from here, I can basically write then this dx is kx p square divided by, see, this is crucial, c0 square by ex minus c0 square by n square. What is this epsilon x you feel? So remember, n is the refractive index in vacuum, right? So nx, ex, epsilon x is nothing but something that we can relate to be the refractive index of the medium, right? Because n is like root epsilon, right? So here is where the medium thing is already coming in. And very interestingly, you can see that this is now a quadratic. It's a quadratic in your refractive index, right? So we are already getting signatures of there being like two sort of things, two values or, two sort of solutions already existing. So that is, this is the seed from which you can get this thing of, two orthogonal polarizations happening and all that, right? However, so now what we can write this is kx p square by some cx square minus c square. And similarly, you have your dy as ky p square by some cy square minus c square. And your dz to be some kz p square cy square, cz square minus c square, right? And what are these cx, cy, cz? They are nothing but your cx, cy, and cz are the principal phase velocities. So now you are seeing that I am actually talking about three different, axes where I have three different phase velocities already, right? So this is where things are getting really, really cool and different. So wrap this up. So from there, we know that we have del dot d is 0, which means that your kx dx plus ky dy plus kz dz is 0.
which essentially means that your p square kx square, you had kx here, cx square minus c square plus ky square by cy square minus c square. Achha, c not tha, just take that as c. Okay, let me just put this here. Az square by cz square minus c naught square equal to zero. So obviously this goes. So what we are essentially getting is very clearly your kx square. Now if I say this is nothing but c zero square by nx square minus c zero square wait, this is problem. Sorry. This is problem. This is not C naught. This is C. I made a mistake. This is not C naught. This is basically C by N, right? So this is the So this is now, this is the thing in the vacuum. Okay, my
sir, why are we denoting C and C zero? Like earlier we used to do C and V, right?
It is possibly, should I change all to V?
I think we should just continue with this, otherwise
it's going to get late. I will in the notes that I'll upload, I'll change. Okay, I will just get late, but yeah, you're right, I should not put. I'll change all this to be n square plus ky square. Let me write from V here, okay? Cy square by. In fact, let me just from here, I'll keep on writing this. These are all this is actually not V. It's not V, no? This is actually that V by N thing. So this is
We should just keep it.
This is actually this one I should keep C. This is not V. Okay, so this one we should keep as C. So this is basically that. Okay. This is V by N z square. But see, this is actually C naught is not. What am I doing, man? This is actually C, velocity of light. No. Yeah, this is all messed up, completely messed up. Right, so I now know this has to be V and this has to be C. Yeah, okay.
Yes, sir. Needs to be VX.
Okay, let me all change all this. This is basically V and that one is C. This C is all crazy. So this is basically VX square minus V square, VY square minus V square, and VZ square minus V square. This this has to be seen. This is
so obviously what I will do is I will try to, the C is gone, so basically now if I, so C is, I can just cancel off C, but then push, interestingly what, because this is the n's are in the denominator, so we basically, if you take a, you know, nx square when LCM and subtract and all that, so you basically will get nx square n square by nx square minus n square plus ky squared n y squared n square by n y squared minus n squared. Aaj hai ulto likha, n squared minus n squared, right? Ye n square hoga na, this is n squared minus n squared, this is also same, this is n squared minus n y squared plus kz squared n z squared n squared by n squared minus n z squared equal to 0, which basically means all my n's go and I have kx squared n x squared by n squared minus n x squared plus ky squared n y squared by n squared minus n y squared plus kz squared n z squared by n squared minus n z squared, n z squared 0. This nx, ny and nz are the principal ri. And here we are going to introduce the concept of your principal, you know, axis. See, so very clearly you can see that all, when both your, all these nx square, ny square, all of these, they actually have two solutions, like n1 and n2, right? So in all three directions, there exist a pair of solutions, right? Of solutions, right? And however, for certain specific, say, solutions n1 and n2, but for certain specific directions of k, you have your n1 equal to n2. Okay, and that, for those things, you, that that particular direction where you have these, you know, where your kx square, ky square, kz square are the same, which is equal to some k square, and your n1 is equal to n2, that is essentially called the optic axis of a crystal. Okay, this is very critical. However, for certain specific directions of k, n1 equal to n2, and this is basically your optic axis, and also you have that for that particular direction, the projections of k are essentially the same, there are, everything is same. Okay, and however, in general, what you have is that in, you know, you when you have nx squared, you basically have two directions, like, you know, it's sort of nx and there is minus nx as well. So you have like a forward and a backward propagating wave. Okay. So in general, you actually can have these, there is this specific direction where you have a single, you know, equivalent kind of a refractive index where the wave is, you know, for you do not basically have the projections. I mean, when so the properties are actually not different. I mean, in that particular direction, if you are incident, then the incident wave essentially does not fragment into different polarizations and different kind of stuff. That is called the optogaxis. But otherwise, you have all kinds of different things that may happen. And whether, you know, this NX, NY, NZ, whether they are all three, you know, different, or whether any two of them are same and all, that defines the symmetry of the crystal. So you have uniaxial, you have biaxial. Biaxial has the least symmetry. Uniaxial has a greater symmetry than that. But there also you have, you know, two polarization directions for, you know, an incident wave that is having a single polarization. But inside the crystal, you actually have two polarization distinctions. Okay. So what one basically concludes from here is that, you know, in general, you have root of nx square, which basically gives nx and minus nx, which are two waves which are propagating in opposite directions. Directions k and minus k. When basically see the kx and minus kx. This is important, and I think what we want to do after this, which is I don't think it's a good idea to start that now. So basically, we want to show that, you know, that the for a given wave vector, the equivalent d vectors that you have, they are actually orthogonal. Okay, so that is very important to show, because you see what we have here is what we shall essentially see is that because we have a quadratic kind of thing. So quadratic matlab ki very clearly there are two refractive indices which essentially mean two phase velocities, right? So that means again the polarization has to be considered. What is the polarization of each of the waves? Okay, so because there are now these two possible, you know, manifestations. I mean, two phase velocities and everything for one incident wave. It is a very important exercise to check what happens to the individual d vectors which are induced because of the anisotropy of the crystal. Okay, so that what should we do? Should we continue this tomorrow and at least end that, or no? Because after this there is a break. So what do you think? Should we have a class tomorrow and finish this orthogonality of d vectors? That gives us some kind of a closure. Do you think we can have a short class tomorrow so that, because I cannot finish anisotropic media, because there is, after this we have the index ellipsoid and all kinds of things, and that takes at least two to three extra class, two classes for sure. But if I take a class tomorrow, then we can basically just finish this orthogonality for of the d vectors. That is nice. So that gives us some kind of a closure. Well, here what we have found is that, you know, you have this kind of a surface we have already coming. So you can see that this is now a kind of a already again defining a surface, and of course this is what we are going to, you know, then label as the index ellipsoid and all that. What do you think? Should we have a class tomorrow at 5 o'clock, or do you want? I don't know. There is a. I think there is a tutorial. You have a. The tutorial as well. Huh? We basically just. It's not. I don't want to extend too much because then again there is again there's going to be no continuity because there is some stuff left here.
Sir, we don't take tutorial in the regular basis, sir. We take tutorial when
so tomorrow then tomorrow a... yeah so tomorrow then can we have a thing at 5 o'clock, because then I will just you know have some kind of closure where you know where for where we show that the d vectors are actually orthogonal for an arbitrary direction of propagation. Today extending this further maybe it's the end of the day and we have gone through a certain part, you know, which is probably should sink in a bit.
Sir,
shall we have a class?
Huh? Show it tomorrow class at 5 p.m. But like others should respond.
Yeah. So is it fine tomorrow 5 o'clock? We just. I don't think it's going to be too long. I'm basically trying to get some closure because continuing today is just does not make sense. So I think some kind of discussion where we kind of you know go to a end this with some you know fixed. You know, some concretization of the idea, which makes, you know, anisotropic media different from isotropic media. I think that is okay. 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 So fine. I think you're all okay. So tomorrow we'll have a short class at 5 o'clock, where I just have some closure. And great. So any other questions?
Sir, I have a question. Can you go back to that slide? The last one.
Yeah.
So this the equation that we have is basically an ellipsoid with the axis kx, ky, and kz, right?
Yes, correct. Yes, right.
Yes. So here, how are you concluding that in every direction there is this pair of solutions n1 and n2 that you will get?
No, because see, you are essentially having some this kind of thing, na? Square and refractive index. So if you have a square, money, there are in principle n1 and n2, which may or may not be positive, negative. I mean, both can be positive or one positive, one negative or whatever. But in principle, you are basically having, if it's a quadratic in n, that means there are two solutions of the refractive index, right? And two solutions of refractive index means there are two waves which are traveling with different phase velocities.
Sir, but this is not like this is not in quadratic in n, because if you multiply out all the three denominators, you'll get n to the power 6. No.
That
n to the power 4. Sorry, n to the power 4. You'll get. And there is nx square as well. To simplify this, if you want to reduce it to an equation, you will multiply this equation with n square minus nx square into n square minus ny square into n square minus nz square. You have n to the power 6 factor.
Not really, right? Because I have some n square, suppose, I mean, basically I have something like, say, something like some a square by some x square minus or basically if I have some x square by some constant, some a square minus x square equal to some constant, say equal to something, and this is not a quad, this is a quadratic only, no? Why is this I'm going to look at each of the directions, right? These are all orthogonal directions.
If you'll multiply both the sides by a square minus x square, then you will have x to the power 4 term.
No, but there is a niche bhi ek,
no, so you multiply this denominator by both the sides, this factor, then you'll get a square minus x square into x square is equals to a square minus x square into b.
No, so but see, wait. This is essentially, I am getting this as a what you have to, we have to remember what we are getting this as. We are getting this as some kind of a so you know, this is you can say that finally what we have got is some kind, you know, so this, we started with the wave equation, right? We started with the wave equation and we got this as a condition, as a condition, okay? And these conditions essentially say that this thing comes to zero, okay?
Yes, now if fine. You think of it,
no, but in the sense that directly giving us solution of this, I don't want a direct solution of this. I have to solve for the D's. Finally, what I need to solve to get the wave is not that. The wave I need to solve, basically this one.
Where is it called? This
this one. Okay, this is what I have to solve. Right, so this is that velocity. So 1D basically has an n square. Okay, so from there you get a solution. You get it is possible to get two kind of waves. I mean, with different, because it's a quadratic now. In order, it is possible to have two waves which have, like, you know, the n1 and n2 or whatever, something like that.
Sir, I think
that, that itself, why we will have two solutions for n, you need to get n from that ellipsoid equation and put it here to get dx, right?
Yeah, in the sense that I see, but here what I have, this is essentially what I have, no? This dx, this is what I finally have, this I actually have. And remember this p, that also has, if I look at what p square, this one, okay, so this also probably, yeah, this is a sort of a complicated thing. I mean, finally what you get here is so yeah, if you come to think of it, then you are getting some d square, I mean some kind of a you have three orthogonal directions and you have some kind of a summation of all those three equal to zero. Now it is not that individually you can say that these are like this. So the whole point is that because you have a quadratic in n, it means that there are two possible, see, because the velocity is obviously not given by square, na? The velocity is given by v by n. From so now, because you have a square, so in principle, the equation which you solve the field is this one.
Yes, no, that slide, can you go to that slide, that last slide. One.
Okay.
So, Hitesh, see the x component, right? So that x component will have two solutions. That is for sure, right?
What Hitesh is saying, if I take this x component and I have to, he's saying that because there is a something like this, he's saying if I multiply this, then this becomes x to the power 4.
Yes.
No. Why will you multiply? You need a solution for x, right?
Right. That is what I'm also trying to say. Why?
Need solution for x.
Yeah, that's why I'm converting into polynomial so that I can find the root of that polynomial.
The thing is that you'll just get repeating solutions.
I couldn't hear, sorry.
Sorry, if you multiply it and convert it to an x power 4 equation, you'll just get repeating solutions.
Yes, repeating solution you will get.
Yeah.
No, exactly. New solution will be there.
New solutions, correct.
You can see now that x is...
Yeah, that is what I said. So if you have something like this, so basically if you have something like this, this will have only two solutions.
Yeah, this will have two solutions.
This will have only two solutions.
Quadratic equation.
This is just a quadratic equation. So if you take this kind of a thing, then you will basically just get two solutions for x.
Sir, you may get repeating solutions, that is fine, but this is definitely not a quadratic solution. This is a quartic equation. You may get imaginary solutions which you can neglect, or negative solutions which does not satisfy the physical conditions.
No, I can't. I can't get your point. Is this equation does not say that x square equals to that constant into a square minus x square?
Yeah, but x square equals to
a square minus x square.
This is fine. Yeah,
this is exactly. This is what you have here.
What is that problem?
So if you have this, then this is the problem. This is the same equation. Why is that?
So we are solving for nx or n.
Nx. Why n? Nx. Of course, nx. That's what I wrote here also, na.
Okay.
Nx. That is what I told you. This is x squared by x
and
square minus
nx
square.
Will have two solutions, n1 and n2.
N1
now, if for there is an axis that n1 equals to n2.
N2,
then
that
axis
is
will
optimus.
Be called optic axis.
Exactly. Oh, okay. That.
If yeah, for okay. X that is exactly. Happen, yeah, then yeah. X axis will be called optic axis. Got the point?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I got it. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. So there is no problem here at all. Okay.
Sir, another question that I have is related to that epsilon naught thing. So, in Jackson, they have considered the relative permittivity.
Okay.
But we are not considering the relative one. We are just considering the epsilon omega itself.
Yeah, absolute curve, whatever. Yes. But we are kind of so that see, we are kind of considering the epsilon not inside that actually. So that I don't think that's too much of a problem, no?
Sir, no. The thing is,
like a constant
from the for the Kronig relations for imaginary part of epsilon, there we need to compute the real part of epsilon minus one, but like this does not dimensionally matches, right? Because one does not have any dimension, but the real part of epsilon will have one unless you are taking the relative permittivity.
No, see,
okay, so
Sam did not consider epsilon zero at all, means that is already epsilon r.
Yes, that is what I'm trying to say. See, so what we wrote basically was this, you know, that epsilon r is basically, you can say epsilon r1, it is essentially epsilon r by this one. This is what we kind of considered as called.
Okay, so this thing is there, right? Okay.
Yeah.
This is
what
I want to
say.
Exactly what we thought.
That equation is minus one, right?
Then it's fine. I was thinking that is not normalized.
That is normalized. That is
obviously epsilon minus one, right? In fact, Jackson probably is the only book which keeps on putting this always. I mean, in most places I've seen, it just has real part and imaginary part. This dividing by epsilon not, it's a normalization factor, which
because
I think
that book is flawless, right?
All possible details.
Yes.
That is ideal. Okay. Okay. So that we will then have a short meeting tomorrow at 5:00 and just finish this part and get some closure. Okay. And then any other question?
Sir, I couldn't understand what you mean by NX has two solutions and the wave is traveling in two different directions. Are these directions orthogonal?
No. That is in the sense that K and minus K, right? So if you say think that NX has, it's a NX square, right? So in principle, you can have an NX and minus X, minus NX, right? So NX and minus NX means, what is the meaning of negative refractive index here? I mean, there is no sort of, you know, the refractive index becoming negative doesn't make sense. What is being meant is that the wave is traveling in the opposite direction. One is traveling at kx, other minus kx. Because you have a quadratic now, nx is
square. We don't have any information, right, from this.
It may not be nx and minus x, or because there is an n square minus nx square. Now, so it can, it is not necessity that you actually have. It's going to be a positive and a negative root. I'm saying in the case of a negative root, the meaning is that there is a wave that is traveling in the opposite direction as the other wave. So there are two distinct phase velocities. That is clear. Okay. So if there is a negative root, that essentially means that the wave is traveling in the opposite direction. Okay. This is what we are trying.
And one more thing. You said that there exists some pair of n1 and n2 where
n1 equal to n2, right?
So
Right.
So this n1, n2 is the like the total n, right? Not nx, ny, nz.
Exactly. So then there is no differential, right? That is, so essentially if you have k square equal to kx square and k equal to ky square to kz square, then there is complete symmetry, right? So then you do not have any different nx, ny. There is only n1. There is just one particular direction where there is one single refractive index, which is that optic axis. And that actually does not, so essentially think of it, when you have a half wave plate or quarter wave plate, if you have the incident polarization in the direction of the optic axis, you get no change. I mean, if the angle of incidence is along the optic axis, then you absolutely have, nothing happens. The crystal does nothing to your wave. It just passes as it is. It is only when you have a particular angle with respect to the optic axis that the incident polarization is projected into two different polarizations, which has two different phase velocities. That is the, see, this is the basis of the whole understanding of anisotropic crystal. If you come in the direction of optic axis, there is no effect on the of the crystal on your wave. Absolutely no effect of the crystal.
So just from seeing the equation, how can I say that if my refractive index is same, then nothing will
In the sense that there is a possibility, there is a possibility of, so let me, if I go back to here. Yeah, good. So you have a possibility where this condition is met, na? Where you have this happening. If you have, then this whole thing becomes very simple, right? And then you have just one n, plus minus n, right? And that basically is the one direction where you do not have any kind of distinction, any. So as per that, there is no anisotropy seen. Okay, if in that direction there is no difference in, you know, I mean, you can have a condition where all these are the same, right? Where this is met.
Okay.
But so that this is like a symmetry x or whatever. Yeah.
Huh. This just means x, y, z, all components are equal. But yeah. Then what does it mean to be?
So that means that their nx, ny, nz are not different, right? You basically have an n square minus some n square minus n zero square, and that n zero essentially is just whatever, you know, different refractive index you have. But when the wave comes out, there is no change. See, the whole question happens, if you think of it, when you come with a different when you come with certain polarization in an anisotropic crystal, there are now two different polarizations which come, which have different phase velocities. Now when they come out of the crystal, these again sort of superpose, and the net effect is the rotation of the initial polarization. The velocity again becomes as velocity in air, but the polarization direction changes. However, if you come in the direction of the optic axis, that does not include, or that does not cause any change in the direction of your input. I mean, there is no projection of the input into two different orthogonal polarizations, or because everything is same, there is only one. Obviously, the crystal itself has a refractive index of the material that is there, but that does not make any difference to the polarization. So whatever polarization you came in with, the same polarization you will exit.
Okay, I get that, but what do you mean by when n1 equal to n2?
See, basically, when you that essentially means that when I solve this equation, say, I will have two roots, which may not be equal to each other. Na? You think of it, but right? I have a solution.
You just said that the two roots are just negative of each other.
No. That may not be. That may not be. So suppose you have a thing like this, right? Then this is not, both are not negative, right?
Okay.
You can have both positive roots also.
So this is solution of nx or
total nx. So I'm saying in general, however, I mean, yeah, well, in general, maybe is in, well, there may be cases when you have negative as well. Okay. So in typically when you solve nx, you will have n1 and n2. Okay. And that they may not be, I mean, you can have n1 and minus n1. Okay, and that basically means that there is one in the positive and one in the negative direction. The two waves which have propagating in opposite directions.
So, along the optic axis, the n1 and n2 are also equal.
Same. There is no difference. There is just one distinct.
And
there is no
And also there is no directionality. All the x,
no,
y.
No. It is basically that is an symmetry axis, you can say. Symmetry axis in terms of properties. So along that direction, the crystal shows itself as same. And there is no directional dependence at all. So any wave along the optic axis goes out unchanged.
Okay.
So therefore, and that is essentially when you did your this is called going into depths, right? When you did your practical, I think you second year also you had that something you had, no? That kya tha? Something you had, right? Malus law. So I think we gave you a quarter wave plate where we told you to do, I think something we had to do, right? So you were strictly told to follow instructions that you should basically ensure that you have a polarizer in front and behind the quarter wave plate. You put the quarter wave plate. I mean, initially you ensured that you have orthogonality, but your total output after polarization 1 and 2 is close to 0. Then you put the quarter wave plate and you rotate the quarter wave plate till you come back to that 0. So what does that mean? That basically means that you are aligning the quarter wave plate to be such that the incident wave that is coming in is along the optic axis. So the quarter wave plate has no effect. That is basically what I am telling you. That is the math of that is this. Now, the moment you rotate the quarter wave plate by 45 degrees, this immediately breaks. Now you have two orthogonal polarizations induced. So you were just told all this, right? You never knew the mathematics. This is the mathematics. The moment you are not along the, when you are parallel to the optic axis, along the optic axis, the quarter wave plate has zero effect. It will just come out. And inside the quarter wave plate, the velocity is V by N, C by N, or whatever you say. That is immaterial because outside it again becomes C. But importantly, there is no rotation of polarization at all. And that is what I mean by this condition, that your Kx all are same. There is one direction in which you do not have any kind of manifestation of the crystal's anisotropy. The crystal appears isotropic. That is called the optic axis. Okay,
got it.
Okay, so tomorrow brief class at 5 o'clock. Great.
Sir?
Shall I end the recording? Is it for this thing?
Sir, little doubt.
Doubt. Then let us keep the recording. Bolo.
So basically, did you want to say that N1 or N2 the pair correspond to left circularly polarized and right circularly polarized?
I'm not going into all that, Shubhranshu. That I am not. There are orthogonal polarizations. That we will see. That is what I want to go in the next one. Next class. Orthogonal. They will be like orthogonal. Like we will show that D1 and D2 are orthogonal. That is exactly. Okay. So that means LCP and RCP essentially.
Okay, and also you, the nx square or ny square, nz square is corresponding to ex, ey, ez. That is assumed, right?
Yeah. Absolutely. Dx, ex. Yeah. Absolutely.
Okay, exactly. And where is the imaginary part considered here?
That at the moment we are basically there is all are quadratic, na? So the phase part. So that is an interesting thing. So we do not need to consider that way. I mean, the way that we are going to, this thing pans out, this whole theory, is that you get two orthogonal polarizations without considering that thing that we see. Remember what, when you did anisotropic media till now, you were just told that there are two these things and one gives a phase when the phase velocities are different and all that. So that phase velocity we represented by if you really think of the theory, even what you learned, you were told that there is an extraordinary ordinary, and then along one of the axes the phase velocity is different, and as a result when it comes out it is manifested as a rotation of the thing. So imaginary part is not really required there also as well, right? What you learned was that you have different propagation velocities of the ex and ey, as a result that manifests itself as a phase, which is the imaginary part. But here what we do, the way we completely, you know, go around this, is that you do not need to kind of invoke. I mean, you will clearly get that
you know, that you basically have two polarization directions with different phase velocities. Very clear.
Okay, so we will consider the real value only.
Yeah, at the moment it is very consistent. You will get the two d1 d2 and the orthogonal polarizations where your two d1s d's are different, that you will say, that you will see.
Okay, okay. Actually, you did, you took the root, I mean epsilon x was there, so epsilon y, epsilon z was also there, so I was little confused what would be
the no but at the moment it's all n square. No,
okay,
you are not considering, you don't need to consider the imaginary part here that way.
Okay, I thought that it is some nx plus I.
No. Refractive index imaginary part. No, that we don't need to, absolutely we are not dealing with that. Okay. Absolutely not dealing with that. That is not there. That makes it much more complicated actually. See, that is coming to, that will have with resonance properties and absorption properties and all that. That we are not dealing with. See, imaginary part deals with attenuation. Okay. And attenuation might actually lead to some depolarization and all that. So that it's much more complicated actually. That we, that is not considered in this theory for diet, for anisotropic media. We don't typically consider that at all. Okay. We basically just say that refractive index, it is just absolutely the real part that we consider. We are not thinking of the absorption at all. Because absorption is very problematic because your initial field and final field are different, and then polarization loss also happens. Because if you think of it, finally we measure the, say, you know, the, you guys know, I will go through Stokes vector, but you guys have done Stokes vector, right? Most of you. So Stokes vector, if you think of it, they are just measurements of intensity, right? So you can see Stokes vector, initial Stokes vector and the final Stokes vector, if they are different, that basically means that, and that will be the case if there is, intensity loss, which means there is absorption. I mean, if there is absorption, there will be intensity loss. So then the Stokes vectors will not be the same, right? So that not being the same, money, when you measure the degree of polarization, you'll find that that has changed. So that means that's going to be, there is a element of depolarization which is going to come. So imagine, so essentially the imaginary part here, if you have to consider that, that that basically causes, you know, degradation of your polarization, you lose polarization. Because you can, you follow the logic, right? Because Stokes vector is clearly the different intensities, right? And intensity going down, money, you will lose polarization.
Okay, yeah, the electrons will be less displaced like that.
Yes, exactly. Polarizability itself will be less.
Okay. Correct.
Yes, it will lose some basic, some ordering of the field will get, you know, the electric field itself will no longer, I mean, there will be an unpolarized part that will come out, which is going to be random.
Okay. And also one little doubt regarding the Maxwell's equation. So is the basics of Maxwell's equation is divergence of E equals to rho by epsilon, where epsilon tensor times the epsilon it depends on the medium, right?
So basic Maxwell's equation is del dot D equal to rho, right? Now D is something we take as the rho can be zero, but D we typically write as epsilon not E, and then that epsilon gets out and we say that del dot E is zero.
Yes, but when you are taking,
so when we are considering this one, then you have to write that you cannot throw that. See, basically, if your E is epsilon, is different in different directions, that means there is a del x, del epsilon x, del epsilon, you know, x and all. And del epsilon x, del x will be there. It will be, so you cannot throw it out.
Yes, because it is direction dependent.
It is direction dependent.
Okay.
That is the main thing. This is very fascinating, actually. This anisotropic media thing is really, really fascinating.
Yes,
really interesting. And yeah, we need to have discussions on this, so let us see. Okay, so I'll stop recording.